5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
I'm from a place where the girls are always looking pretty. You might have heard of us. We call it Shy City. We build champions here who define gritty. We don't do excuses. We don't do pity. Rose is coming back stronger. That's a guarantee. Cutler's coming back too. He's beastly. Throwing it to Marshall. The title's ours easily. Blackhawks are winning titles. Trophy looking massive. Don't forget about the Cubs, Sox, Crosstown Classic. With so much greatness, we gotta show bravado. You got your boys Ambro and Mike Mercado.
Welcome into the Chicago Beat, everybody. I'm Mike Mercado, as always, with my best friend, Secret Producer Man. It is Monday, August 5th, 2013, and you're on the Chicago Beat. We got a lot to get into today, guys. Alex Rodriguez, pending suspension, is right on the deck. We have not heard any official words. We're going to get into that. Johnny Manziel, now the Heisman winner, under investigation for taking money for his autographs. We got some Bears news. We got some Cubs news. We got some Sox talk. So we're going to get a lot into today. Don't forget, you can follow us everywhere in the universe. We're on Twitter at the Chicago Beat. You can like us on Facebook at the Chicago Beat. And you can find all our work, articles, past shows at thechicagobeat.yolasite.com or fullscalesports.com. So right away, I want to get into White Sox versus Yankees today at U.S. Cellular Field. Normally, it's always a big deal when the New York Yankees come into town in Chicago. It always is. It's a New York team. It's the Yankees. Today, it's a little bit different, though. Alex Rodriguez, if you believe the reports by USA Today and the last 2 weeks of ESPN reporting that he will be suspended, today is the doomsday, as you could say, or judgment day, you could say, for a lot of these players. Alex Rodriguez, according to some reports of the USA Today, will be suspended the rest of this year and the rest of the 2014 season. Now, it will be under the drug policy, so he will not be immediately suspended. It might take, especially if he goes through arbitration or, you know, if he appeals the process, it might take him a little bit while. But I was on Biggs Talk Golf last week, and you can hear him on the JDS Network. We were talking about Ryan Braun and how the kind of situation it is with him up in Milwaukee and for Brewers fans. And I find it interesting that this Alex Rodriguez story has kind of taken the focus away from Ryan Braun. And I was trying to figure out why. Why is that the case? Well, it's simple to me. It kind of dawned on me, why is it that people find it such a big deal, especially with A-Rod? It's because A-Rod was the chosen one. A-Rod was supposed to be the one that was the clean player that did it right, the number one draft pick, who was going to get rid of that tainted record from Barry Bonds. He had the look, he had the swag, he had the talk, and he was supposed to be the guy. He played in Seattle next to Griffey. I mean, he went to Texas. He's been in New York. He fit the mold of what you would think the new home run king was going to be. And then to hear this, to get caught once is one thing. To get caught twice is another thing. But then to be found, or allegedly be found, to be bribing people, to try to get information away from people, that's where you made the mistake, A-Rod. Because now you basically said to Bud Selig and the MLB, I don't care what you think. I'm going to do everything in my power to make sure you can't do your job. And we've seen the thing about baseball, in any sport. It's the lying, it's the hiding, it's the deceitfulness that these organizations, that these leagues, these commissioners don't want to see. They don't want to see their investments. And that's frankly what these people are. Our investments do that to them. Alex Rodriguez is due over $90 million, guys. And if he misses these next two seasons, or this half of the season and next season, he'll only make $60 million. Now, again, to us, $60 million is a lot of money, because it is. But to him, it's not. To him, it's principal. To him, it's, that's the money I earned, you know, quote unquote earned. So it's a very dark, very sad story to talk about. But it's the world in sports that we live in today, where it's come down to, we idolized these people for so many years. Baseball did not do its job. When I was growing up in the 90s, in 98 especially, with the home run race between Sammy Sosa and Mark McGwire, baseball did not do anything about it, guys. They didn't want to do anything about it. It's making them too much money. And if you're a business owner, if you're that type of administrator, if that's the role that you play in life, you understand the bottom dollar is what's important, because that's what keeps jobs. That's what makes jobs. So they allowed this to happen. And now they're upset. Now they're upset that their players took advantage of it, that the people don't want it anymore. Well, whose fault is it? It's everybody's fault. It's the fans' fault. It's the fans' fault for being outraged, you know, being upset now. But we weren't upset back then when we were trying to get back into the sport after the lockout. It's the owner's fault for letting it happen under their watch. It's the manager's fault for the same reason. It's the player's fault for not having any accountability, for being liars, for being cheaters. It's Bud Selig's fault because he knew about it. It's the Players Association's fault. They didn't want a drug test. And now everybody's paying for it. Fans are paying for it. You think the fans of Milwaukee deserve to see this happen? I'm a Cub fan. We watch baseball here in Chicago. You think anybody deserves that type of treatment when it comes from your star athlete that you put on a pedestal that you invest so much money in to buy their jerseys and to pay tickets? I'm not saying I'm perfect. None of us are perfect. And I don't want to be one of these guys who, just because I have a microphone, I'm going to tell people how they should live their life. I've done bad stuff in my life. I do bad stuff in my life. Stuff that's not good for my body. That doesn't change the fact, though, that I'm not getting paid to do things like that. I'm not getting paid $100 million to hit a baseball on the idea that I'm doing truthfully. You know, if it was one thing, a Major League Baseball didn't test for it. It was no testing like they did in the 90s. There's no testing. We're not going to. You can't get in trouble for it. They may be illegal in the rest of the world, in the real world, but in our little baseball world, it's not. You know what? So be it, because that's how the NFL is. But that's not how it is. We know that you're not supposed to use these drugs. We know you're not supposed to cheat this way. I mean, Pete Rose didn't even cheat. He bet on his team to win games, and he is banned for life. But somebody who directly is involved in the game, who's directly changing the outcomes of these games because of this unfair advantage, and it was both pitchers and hitters for the longest time, and it's still that way, that's not right. And there has to, and now we're being hypocritical about it. And I think that was the biggest thing that we see here in Chicago, because you talk to Chicago fans when it comes to steroids, and they're as open-minded, and they're not as shocked anymore. Because when you've gone through the Sammy Sosa's and you were part of that home run race, you knew exactly what it was. You knew what was going on. And if you're a Sox fan, you had Frank Thomas. Never once has there ever been a word spoken of him taking steroids. But you always had in the back of your mind, because that was the generation it was. So as much as we enjoyed the, you know, big hurt, if you were a Sox fan, it was always in the back of everybody's mind. And of course with Sammy, I mean, you saw, I mean, people saw it with Sammy, and especially when it started getting to the forefront of what steroids really did, it was a done deal. People knew already. And that's why you see the Cubs disassociating themselves from it. But, I mean, I see here on Twitter, at the Chicago Beat, which you guys can follow us and tweet at us, you know, here's from a Henry. Henry puts, A-Rod is a big cheat, deserves to never play again. Totally understandable. Then you have people on the other side of it, you know, like Clarissa right here on Twitter, saying, everybody cheats, why are we witch hunting him? It's another good point. Baseball wants him. That's why. Because he stuck the middle finger at them. You know, I don't buy this either. Tell me, how is the Tour de France doing when everybody cheats? Why, you have to go down to the 36th place to finally get a real champion that hasn't been caught with steroids in their body? You know, I understand when cancer patients have to take HGH. When somebody is in a bad accident or they're in a something like that. You're talking about a sport. Now, you can't blame some of these people. Some of these people come from poor countries, poor environments, where if the only way between them and $1 million is by injecting themselves some HGH and hitting the ball, why wouldn't they do it? I ask you guys that. Would you do it? See, these are the conversations people aren't having. And I think because my audience is the best audience around on the interweb, I thought it was time we had it. We have more coming up next year on the Chicago Beat. For the quickest quote and the best shipping, visit inflightexpress.com. They are the best shipping department in the state of Illinois. That's inflightexpress.com, who proudly delivers the Chicago Beat. So before we hit the break, me and Secret Producer Man, we're talking about the whole A-Rod situation, since he's going to be down here in Chicago playing the White Sox. He is penciled in to be playing tonight. And, of course, if you believe it, if you've been reading the reports and everything, there is a chance that he will be suspended, if not today, tomorrow. And I guess that's been the case, hell, all week. But and there's other stories going around. We had the Riley Cooper situation where he was saying the N-word at a concert to a security guard. And the Philadelphia Eagles put him on a leave. teammates like LeSean McCoy are speaking out against him. And I think I don't want to get into a whole discussion about race. I mean, we can. This is the platform that we could do it. We're very sensitive towards it. I mean, as a Hispanic man, I understand how the racial issue goes into everything. But I think the one thing that I really want, I took away from this whole situation is the society that we live in now. It's a society where 15 years ago, we thought it was okay for a black man to say the N-word to another black man. We thought, oh, well, whatever. You know, no big deal. Just like a Hispanic man would say a derogatory term that normally would be conceived of a white person said it, we could say it to another one. I do it all the time. I try not to, but it is what it is, okay? I have a lot of black friends. I have a lot of white friends. I'm a Hispanic. I hear the way we talk to each other. We're too loose with our words. You know, we're too loose to say certain things that because we feel in a comfort situation. And that's what we have to get out of. And I think Stephen A. Smith said it yesterday on First Take on ESPN2. And he basically just goes off and he talks about how we were too comfortable with saying these kind of things. And I respect that from Stephen A. Smith because he's somebody who a lot of people give a hard time about being too favorable when it comes to racial situations. But you have to be sensitive to these sorts of things. These are teammates. And that's been one of the things that we've heard on Twitter is, can't they get past it? It has nothing to do with getting past something. You have to be willing to trust that person. And if that trust is affected at all, and I may not buy it, you know, I don't have very thin skin. I have thick skin. Things like that don't bother me. But that's not my choice to tell somebody that if it should bother you or it shouldn't. If it bothers you, if it bothers any portion of society, it should not be said. Just because it doesn't bother me doesn't mean that it doesn't bother somebody else. Just because Riley Cooper felt like he could say it, even if he was drinking, and I put into consideration, yeah, he had some drinks in him, you're still responsible for what you said. And he even admitted to so much though. And then I get it on Twitter right here. Again, here's one from, who is this from? Secret Producer Man, who is this from? Kyle? Kyle puts, Roger Goodell should have done more. Yeah, I think so too. I think just to set a precedent, he could have suspended for two preseason games. He could have fined him some money as well. The Eagles did what they did. Some people aren't too happy about what the punishment that they gave to Riley Cooper. That's not the point though, guys. The point is not punishing this man. The point is us. We have to get past that. Go to an NBA game and that's all you hear. Okay? Then go to a basketball game in Humboldt Park. You'll hear some bad stuff said between Hispanic men. We as a people need to stop doing that. And sports is supposed to be the reason why we do. I get it, competitiveness. I'm competitive in this radio station. If I get heated, I get it. That's how humans are, especially when you're in that type of profession where it's a cutthroat. Every day could be your last day at your job. But we have to get past that, guys. And then you have guys like Michael Vick who are trying to say, hey, you know, let's forgive him. I moved on from it. Not everybody's like that. Not everybody has thick skin. It has nothing to do with sensitivity. It has to do with that's a derogatory word. It was meant to put people down. I don't care how many rap songs put it on there. I don't care how free a white person feels to say it nowadays. I don't care how open-minded people are. Still not something you're supposed to say. You know, we hear the B word all the time on any song. Doesn't matter if it's country, rap, rock. You wouldn't call your mother it, would you? That's all I'm saying, guys. They're grown men. I don't want to baby them. I'm not here, again, pointing the finger and wagging my finger and saying, hey, you can't do this, you can't do that. But you can't be surprised when the outrage is the way it is. And again, we have the best fans here in the Chicago Beat, so I love hearing from you guys. I mean, I hear right now, again, this is from Shannon on Twitter. Excuse me, on Facebook at the Chicago Beat. You can follow us both at the Chicago Beat on Twitter and on Facebook. She writes, We have to live to learn and forgive and forget. Like, words are only words. It's true. Yeah, words are only words, but now when you're playing 16 games and killing, you know, sacrificing your body for other men, if you can't trust them, if you don't have that love for that person, you're not going to do it. I can promise you that much right now. And that's the truth about football. It's like, you got to trust the man to your right and to your left. And that's the only way teams win Super Bowls. We got Johnny Manziel, Johnny Football Talk, coming up next here on the Chicago Beat. For the best youthful look at sports, news, and entertainment, keep it here on the Chicago Beat.
sweat and my rust. I'm breathing in the chemicals.
So I don't know if you guys heard this story. Kyle Long tweeted out last night, the Chicago Bears first round pick, about how they left a tarantula on his bed and training camp and how he took it. This made me think how, while we were in break, how all the terrible things I've done to Secret Reducer Man, like putting soap in his coffee and letting the air out of his tires and stealing his girlfriend's. Oh, man, speaking of stealing their girlfriends, let's talk a little SEC. Of course, we all know here in Chicago about corruption and stuff. So Johnny Manziel, the Heisman winner, Johnny Football, is now under investigation by the NCAA for apparently getting money for autographs that he signed at the NBA Finals, the National Championship, a big event. I'm not 100% sure. You know what these stories, there's always mixing reports coming in and out. The only thing I find interesting is the hatred towards this kid. For some reason, people are hating the fact that he's a quarterback in an SEC Texas school who happens to have family money and is good. How many of you, I'm 23 years old, okay? How many of you, if you had money, would be doing these kind of things? Going to the finals, going to the beach. You're the number one football player in the country right now. And people are hating on him about it because he needs to act a certain way. Guys, he's not a professional. He's not getting paid for this. Let the kid be. I just don't get the hatred towards him. And I, one of a very talented young man, and Mike Pendleton, always gets into with me about all this nonsense with him. And even ESPN is putting up on the bracket that he went to the NBA Finals. I'm like, what is wrong with people? Are we really that desperate to make up stories? And the only reason I bring this up, because it almost reminds me of Jay Cutler. Not the same type of story, but how we're always looking to pick at him. We're always looking to make a story about something as if he's doing something that's affecting us. When all in fact that happens is he plays to win the game. I've never seen Johnny Manziel not be good in a game. Last time I checked, he was the team that beat Alabama. He's the Heisman winner. He arguably is a top 10 draft pick right now. Now, he may be suspended. That's a lot of rumors going around about 2 games, 4 games. Either way, it doesn't change the fact where his draft, he's not going to be at Texas A&M next year. And it brought us back to this point. Me and Secret Producer Man were talking about this. Have you ever seen anybody shoot up so fast of stardom and then be taken down so fast in the city of Chicago? Patrick Kane came to mind because Patrick Kane was a winner. He's a two-time winner. But as we all know, is if you're not winning and you're doing crazy things or you're doing a little bit of shenanigans, you could get in trouble. And that's what happened with Patrick Kane is he was put on the limelight. He was put on the forefront, and he had some situations, and he worked his way out of it. He's a two-time champion. He's a cold, you know, he's done it all. So that's what it brings me to Johnny Manziel is people want to proclamate this. Kid's only 20. How can you do that? And then in the city of Chicago, where we don't have a lot of college sports teams that are as dominating, that are winning 10 games and going to national championship, on consideration for national championship games, unlike Northwestern may be on its way to a Rose Bowl, which we will get into, guys. By the way, if you're college fans, don't worry. We got some Northwestern talk coming up, I believe, in 2 weeks, Secret Producer Man? 3 weeks. Okay, 3 weeks, we're going Illinois and Northwestern talk. So with that in mind, you got to be fair to the situation when it comes to Johnny Manziel. You can't just go out here and say because he's got money and he's done this and he's on Twitter and he's a 20-year-old kid, man. I've met some arrogant 20-year-old kids that don't have nearly as much on their resume. Just keeping that in mind. Just keeping that in mind. We wrap up shop next here on the Chicago Beat. I hope everybody enjoys the rest of their Monday. Don't forget, you can follow us everywhere in the universe. We're on Twitter at The Chicago Beat. You can like us on Facebook at The Chicago Beat. You can see all of our work, past shows, cool articles at thechicagobeat.yolosite.com. And for more national news, visit fullscalesports.com. Tonight, it's A-Rod coming to Chicago. Will he play? Won't he play? The Cubs are off. Blackhawks and Bulls, hiatus. We're still kind of nursing our hangovers over the Stanley Cup. I'm still doing a Secret Producer, man. I don't care. I don't care if they have the main news. I'm going to talk about my Blackhawks. Bears preseason. Oh, that's right. Before we leave, there was a preseason game on last night, wasn't there? Dolphins, Cowboys. Who really cared? I saw Kyle Orton in the game for one series, and the minute he was on the game, and then he was out, I'm like, I'm out. I went to the gym instead. But Bears preseason, cannot wait to get that started. I believe it's Cleveland. Yesterday was Bears family night at Soldier Field. There were some injuries that are coming out. NFL season. We're going to get into that on Friday. Friday's all Bears. We're doing football Fridays from now on. I can't wait to really get that started for the Chicago Bears. We have a lot of stuff coming at you guys. It's going to be really cool stuff. For everybody here at the ICB Lombard Studio, for Secret Producer Man, I'm Mike Mercado. You've been on the Chicago Beat.